practical details in Swedish for those who will stay the whole day, because this is a day where we start with the Kristi Stendahl Memorial Lecture, which will be in English, and then after that, half of this crowd will stay on for more lectures and workshops. Together with Paideia, the Center for Interfaith Dialogue in Stockholm has arranged the Kristi Stendahl Memorial Lecture since 2009. Kristi Stendahl, he returned to Sweden to become Bishop of Stockholm between 1984 and 1988, after having served as Dean of Harvard Divinity School for many years. And he had a great interest in interfaith dialogue, especially Jewish-Christian dialogue, and therefore we decided to have this annual lecture on interfaith matters. And Christer was also an important partner when Paideia was founded, so that's why it's natural to have Paideia as our partner for this lecture. We are very happy about that. Christer Stendahl, I remember him, he was my ordination bishop, and I remember that he often talked about the concept of metanoia, conversion. And he said that really, he was a New Testament scholar and did much research on St. Paul, and he said that metanoia in Greek doesn't really mean conversion, in the sense, especially in Swedish, it's called omvändelse, and that sort of means that you're going in one direction and then you turn maybe and go back, or in another direction because you realized you were on the wrong direction. But he said that no, metanoia, that has more to do with a change of mindset, a raised consciousness about understanding more about what you are about. So that was what happened to St. Paul at his so-called conversion experience. Metanoia is a very important, was a very important word, I think, for Christer Stendahl. And therefore, I was so happy when our lecturer today, Professor Regina Polak, decided to have as the title of her lecture, Migration, a Chance for Metanoia. Regina Polak is associate professor at the Department for Practical Theology at the University of Vienna, and she has been engaged in a research project on migration and religion. And I also learned yesterday that she is also very engaged in Jewish-Christian dialogue, is a coordinator of Jewish-Christian dialogue groups in Austria. So we're very happy, and it's an honor to say welcome to Regina Polak, and the floor is yours.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for this very warm introduction. And first of all, I want to thank you for your invitation, which is also a great honor for me. As I have been informed by Helene, amongst you, there are a lot of experts who are engaged in receiving refugees and working for integration. And as members of Migration Society in the United States, in Israel and in Europe, we all have some kind of migration experience with flight and migration. Some of us may even be people with personal migration history. So I hope I can give you some inspiring ideas for reflecting your migration experience. You will find a handout on your chairs. You have to share it so you can follow the structure, make yourself comfortable. It will take a little time. First point, ringing the inner theological sense of flight and migration today. In my lecture, I want to present some practical theological reflections on flight and migration, which can be considered one of the most challenging global problems of the 21st century. My reflections are rooted in a Roman Catholic point of view on the phenomena. the aim, or my aim, is trying to ring the inner theological sense of the current historical events Europe is confronted with in the context of flight and migration. This is, of course, a risky undertaking, as all totalitarian leaders have pretended to know the meaning of history, like, for instance, the Austrian Führer Adolf Hitler, who legitimized the murder of 6 million Jews by referring to the will of God. So trying to understand the historical and the theological meaning of contemporary times can just lead to questions and fragments. But as a Christian, believing in a history of salvation of mankind by God, it is a religious duty to at least try to do so. The inner sense of history, however, will be revealing itself in the course of time, and it will be our descendants and, above all, the Lord, who will judge by the fruits of our contemporary decisions. Facing all the risks of my theological enterprise, I'm deeply convinced that there is no alternative to such a project, which, of course, has to be realized in a common global effort. In his research on the transformation from ancient time to the Middle Ages, the process called the Great Migrations, the Austrian historian Walter Pohl shows the importance of collective and political narratives supporting the necessary reform of social space by making available differentiated knowledge and highly developed systems of interpretations of social transformation processes. He says, without such a level of abstraction enabling to understand social phenomena as a whole, there is no possibility to solve problems sustainably. Thus, historical research has shown that flight and migration could be shaped more justly, more humane, and peacefully when societies were able to orientate themselves on collective leading narratives, or were at least ready to develop such narratives after political and human catastrophes. Remember the Geneva Convention as a result of the mass migrations and deportations during and after the Second World War, the proclamation of the human rights after the Shoah, or the sonnet on the pedestal of the Statue of Liberty by the Jewish poet Emma Lazarus, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. You know it. It's an impressive expression of the identity of the United States as an immigration society. In the times of the Great Migrations, it was the Christian narrative on the unity of people that supported the transformation crisis then. As we know today, it were the Jews who were the victims of this unifying process, so we are not allowed to repeat this story in the way our ancestors did. But the idea of the unity of mankind, having its origin in the narratives of the people of Israel, probably still can be a powerful vision for today. So I hope to inspire you with my ideas and look forward to a fruitful debate on my main thesis afterwards. Migration offers a chance for metanoia, respectively conversion, for individuals as well as for society, for religion as well as for politics. Point two, metanoia. Yet conversion as a chance might not sound very attractive for many people in contemporary European society, as it has been associated with moral suppression by fear and terror, or with coercion, prosecution, and murder, especially of Jews and other religious minorities. So let me remind you that in the New Testament, Jesus of Nazareth is speaking of, as you said, metanoia, which describes, as you said, a process of learning and transforming oneself first of all, towards God and His kingdom. This metanoia is deeply connected with an inner as well as an external change. learning to love God and human beings, and deeply connected with this, engaging for a just society. Of course, this process also implies self-reflection, self-critics, and repenting, and might not be very comfortable. But Jesus frames this challenging process with a covenant. The time has come, he says in Mark 1:15, the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Repent is the translation for metanoete, which first of all means transforming the way you perceive and interpret reality. Meta means transcending the reality as we know it by noein, a Greek word, which means perceiving, reflecting, thinking, and interpreting. By this metanoia, people can realize the presence of the kingdom of God. The Greek word translates the Jewish duty of, I don't know how to pronounce it, teshuvah or tshuvah, I think both is correct, the repentful reversal towards God and his Torah. Thus, Jesus' idea of metanoia and conversion is a deep Jewish experience of faith, learning that mankind already lives within the kingdom of God. Therefore, the process of metanoia can be interpreted not as the moral condition to get aware of the kingdom of God, but as realizing the kingdom as element in which this challenging transformation takes place and reveals itself as a process of liberation. Ethical behavior, therefore, is the result of the spiritual, liberating experience of the presence of the kingdom of God. This experience is the basis for being able to change the individual, the social, and the political life as it empowers to keep the law of God voluntary. It is this meaning of conversion I refer to when I claim flight and migration to be a chance for Europe to transform. But of course, this transformation is a hard task connected with a lot of painful findings and huge individual and political changes. Let me now go into detail. In the following six steps, I will describe the currently upcoming process of metanoia for Europe. You can follow them on the handout. The first step, realizing and recognizing the breaking in of global reality. As already said, since autumn 2015, Europe is no longer able to ignore the thousands of refugees. Okay?
Yeah, you need to speak very much into the...
Yes, it's better that. Yeah. Since autumn 2015, Europe is no longer able to ignore the thousands of refugees at its borders any longer. Europe has been wakened up rudely. Of course, neither from a global nor from a local point of view, flight and migration are new issues for Europe. What is happening now can be seen as a break-in of reality. Especially Western Europe, where two generations have been living in peace and wealth since the Second World War, and yesterday evening I was learning that Sweden even has been living in peace for 200 years. Europe has to learn, and Sweden has to learn, that poverty, violence, and war are the reality for millions of people in the world. Europe has been successful avoiding to notice this global reality by building a fortress within the last decades. There are several reasons why this fading and splitting out no longer works. Europe has to learn to accept this changing reality. The global crisis Europe is confronted with will not be solved just in a socio-technocratic way, nor will Europe ever will be able to return to former times. Europe has been a migration continent for a century and has to recognize that flight and migration shatter traditional concepts of state and nation, of ethnos and law, that they accelerate plurality and mobility and create identities that no longer fit into the classic frameworks of home, we call it Heimat in German, and outland. Europe thus has to accept the new times approaching, meaning to learn to live in diversity and engaging for global justice. Pope Francis described this situation as such. He said, we are not living an era of change, but a change of the era. At the conference of the German Catholic bishops in February 2016, the assigned High Commissioner of the United Nations, Volker Türk, put it like that. The current refugee crisis offers Europe the possibility of a new enlightenment, learning the global reality of mankind and given the opportunity to prove its values, human dignity and human rights, freedom, solidarity and justice, democracy and rule of law. He reminded the audience of European history, which caused overwhelming suffering by racism, anti-Semitism, violence and war, which forced Europe to develop these values. From a theological perspective, the High Commissioner recalled the biblical tradition in secular words. Remembering the own history of suffering, as well as the own responsibility for flight and migration, obliges to care for the refugees and together with them fight for their rights. By doing this, the contemporary refugee crisis could turn out to be, theologically speaking, a revelation. With the eyes of faith, the refugee's arrival could teach God's will today. Theologically spoken, we are watching the break-in of God's reality in our times. This always implies decisions, as we learn in Matthew 25. If the High Commissioner trusts in enlightenment for Europe caused by flight and migration, religious people could do this as well. Second step, resistance. But we all know that such a view is scarcely shared by European populations and also by Christians. Narratives on flight and migration are dominated by problems and deficits. Right authoritarian parties are booming all over Europe. Fear and hatred against refugees and migrants are growing. At least there is a lot of resistance against the necessity to change. What are the reasons for this fundamental resistance, which to my opinion does not have just rational reasons? From a global point of view, Europe is still not the most concerned continent by flight and migration. Just 14% of the 65 million refugees fleeing from religiously or ethnically argued violence, from war and environmental catastrophes, from hunger and poverty, striving for survival and a better life, 14% were accepted by industrialized countries. In 2015, just 1 million refugees came to Europe, whereas 1.6 million people stay in the Turkey, now it's even more, 1.2 million in the Lebanon and 600,000 in the Jordan. Europe's reaction is a shame because of the global relations. I do not see a reason at all for the apocalyptic mood in Europe these days, being frightened to be drowned by floods and waves and all the other metaphors for water of migrants. Flight and migration are also no new phenomena for Europe. On the contrary, Europe has a long tradition with such experiences and therefore should be able to remember such tragedies. Just look back at the 20th century. After the First World War, masses of deportations took place, forced by nation-building policy of the winners, argued with the ethno-political ideology of the whole continent, supported by academic racism. Especially in Eastern Europe, millions of people were deported, pogroms of Jews exploded. The Second World War resulted in up to 50 million victims, soldiers, population, massacres, and the abyss of the Shoah. after the war, 140 million refugees moved through the world, 60 million people alone in Europe. Europe did manage these challenges with a great amount of solidarity. So did Germany and Austria, and yesterday I learned also Sweden, during the Hungarian uprising in 1956, the Prague Spring in 1968, and the Yugoslavian Civil War in the 90s. Europe was much poorer then. The current situation was not unforeseeable either. Migration experts have been warning about the arriving poor for decades. The growth of the desert in the Sahel, land grabbing in many African regions, huge arms supply and the wars of aggression and civil wars in the Near East and Africa were and are obvious hints for the current situation. Last but not least, Syria has been suffering a dreadful drought for 5 years, the ecological background of the war. And the industrial mass agriculture under the control of international companies will expulse millions of farmers in the future. Flight and migration will not stop. Facing these facts, the European resistance seems awkward. Europe obviously suffers from collective historical amnesia and contemporary repression of reality. What is going on with Europe? Third step, the return of oppressed memories. There are a lot of reasons for the current societal atmosphere as well as for the policy that prefer fighting against refugees and walling off. You know many of them. Let me list three of them that usually are not mentioned in the public discourse. First, from a socio-psychoanalytical point of view, the fight against the victims probably can root in the fight against Europe's own memories of pain and of guilt. On the one hand, this means that the suffering and the poverty of the refugees can remind especially the older population of their own history of flight and poverty. Not having rehabilitated these memories, this might hurt and wake up the old fear and forgotten hunger which have been oppressed. Never will we be suffering again. Never will we be poor again. In Austria, for instance, you often can hear these days that no one helped us after the war. We had to stay here and struggle with the problems. They just forget the Marshall Plan and are full with resentment and acerbity. It is not by chance as well that especially the Eastern European countries are repelling asylum seekers. The descendants of those who did not flee in 1956 and 1968 are full with anger and defense. The history of real socialism as well as of fascism is hardly rehabilitated. The old elites are still reigning, and the majority of the population thus is open-minded towards racism and right-wing authoritarian politics. So the non-adequately treated guilt by the generation of the war and totalitarian times might also be an important source for the refugees' refusals. Except Germany, and much later, if so, Austria, the confrontation with the political guilt, mainly toward Jews, was not a topic for most of the Western European populations, especially on the family level, nor has there been any substantial debate on the political and societal guilt during the totalitarian times in the Eastern states. Therefore, there is a long tradition of looking away from victims and avoiding political responsibility that may be awake these days. European populations have been used to political violence, to disesteem human dignity and justice, to deportation and hatred against minorities for centuries. Conferred to history, democracy and human rights are still young achievements and obviously not rooted deeply enough. Why then should people resist against inhuman asylum politics? Refusal of guilt turns into refusal of refugees as the identification with victims might be threatening. As historical and psychoanalytical research show, Such never rehabilitated memories often are transmitted unconsciously to the descendants as a political habitus and by restaging authoritarian and racist political discourses, structures, and processes. Secondly, there is a huge political interest to distract from the inner European problems, especially from the consequences of the financial crisis, the economic crisis, and the expensive rescue in European bank systems. Growing unemployment also in Europe, also in Vienna, which is one of the richest cities of the world. Poverty and therefore fragile social cohesion. Also the still existing imperialistic economic and political power over developing countries and the dependence on their fossil fuels are dimensions many Europeans do not want to be reminded of. It would mean to realize that Europe is living on the cost of the global poor and involved into structures of political sin. Great parts of society therefore perceive the current situation as a decline, even as a dystopia. Thus it is much easier to put the blame for all these problems on the arriving strangers than to ask self-critically for the interrelations of political and economical power, the neoliberal economic system and the growing inequality. Fighting refugees draws the curtain over the real occurring economical and ecological problems. Migration policy, therefore, can also be seen as a diversionary tactic forced by a neoliberal worldview that puts the responsibility for collapses or individuals instead of asking for structures of distribution of resources and power relationships. And thirdly, there might be spiritual reasons. Many politicians and researchers are talking about the European fear or the anxiety. I think the best word is the German word Angst of the population. Of course, there are rational reasons for such fears. The fear of losing the job, the fear of poverty and suffering, of losing security and welfare. But this kind of fears are also transforming the richer and even the most powerful parts of society. Thus, fear turns out to be a disguise for other emotions and a kind of self-centered narcissism. Martha Nussbaum is a theory of Martha Nussbaum, a famous political scientist. She puts it like this. Angst maybe is the most comprehensive description for all human guilty pleasures. It is a kind of concupiscence, fear, envy, and also hatred. Lucky be the ones who are aware enough to this problem to be able, for the most humble effort, arresting the dreary bias by angst. The natural desire of the human soul is focused on the protection of the ego. If she is right, one could perceive the European fear also as a loss of spiritual values, of sharing, solidarity, even love and mercy on others, turning into hard-heartedness. Has the spiritual consciousness of being connected with other human beings been destroyed by an exaggerated, egotistic individualism and historical amnesia? And what about the missing fear on all the issues which we really should be frightened of? The fear of the ecological crisis, the neoliberal power of multinational enterprises, the growing masses of economically superfluous people. Think of Industry 4.0, which is approaching us. If fear of social insecurity rises and people get the impression of a fragile social cohesion, hatred against other human beings can rise. Then minorities are used to put the blame on strangers and growing diversity. Indeed, xenophobia and its relatives are not a law of nature, not a psychological law of nature, but have a long tradition as hermeneutics for social problems, not only in Europe. These are the results of a long-term study on group-related hostility against human beings, being divided into useful human beings and less useful human beings. In Germany, 40% of the peoples say that there are useful peoples and there are people we do not use, and if the economic situation gets worse, they should not be supported. 40%. If these diagnoses are right, then it will be a long and hard way till the arrival of refugees turns out to be a chance for enlightenment and new experience of God. Above all, Europe has to dare self-enlightenment. It has to identify and change its involvements into structures of global injustice. This will only work if a huge part of the European population allows the refugees to touch their hearts. Of course, you are here, and there are also large groups of committed people. I heard wonderful stories yesterday evening about this kind of human resistance and engagement. But are they enough for the necessary transformation of the heart, which is the basis for a political change? But there is hope nevertheless. If people can learn the habit to hate other people, they can also learn to love them. Or theologically spoken, Europe finds itself within a situation of God's judgment. Europeans have to take a decision how they want to perceive the refugee crisis and hence act. Fourth step, discovering migration as a learning space. If Europe wants to pass this challenge, it has to develop other perceptions, perspectives, and narratives on flight and migration. One possibility could be to discover them as a learning space. Here are two reasons for this suggestion. The first reason, from a philosophical point of view, the migrant can be perceived as a window through which the backward people can learn to view the world. In German, this is a pun, because the word for backward and being mentally retarded is the same. The migrant also can be seen as a mirror in which the backward can see themselves, albeit distorted. This perspective was suggested by Wilhelm Flusser, a Jewish philosopher who fled from the Czech Republic to Brazil in 1939. The migrant, as a mirror, allows the inhabitants to identify issues that are faded out, split off, or tabooed within his own society and can therefore open processes of self-reflection and self-recognition. So the faithful migrant, for instance, can reveal the tabooed role of religion in a secular society. This process can raise new questions. For instance, on the public and ambivalent function of religion in society, which can foster but also hinder integration by increasing problems or being part of finding solutions. As both migration and religion are in some way strangers for European secular societies, the ambivalent reaction towards both can mirror the ambivalence towards the experience of the alien and the widespread inability to deal with difference, diversity, and strangeness. Of course, such confrontations with inner problems are painful. But transformation by pain is probably a very important way to grow in humanity and justice towards refugees and migrants. Being a window into the world, the migrant can probably support such processes by opening perspectives and widening horizons, learning about other cultures, about history and politics, and thus develop the awareness of being one mankind. Hence, the inhuman dimensions of every human culture, also of the European culture, could be transformed into a more humane civilization, as Tsvetan Todorov has shown. From the point of social science, the theory of inclusion also offers a way to understand flight and migration as learning spaces. The concept of inclusion also provides an alternative to the model of integration, as the latter in reality leads to assimilation on the one, or segregation and marginalization on the other hand. Interpreting the migrants' problems from the view of the theory of inclusion enables the majority to identify those actors, structures, institutions, and processes that impede, damage, or even destroy also the life of other groups in society and prevent society as a whole to integrate human beings. As a result, flight and migration become learning spaces for the whole society and can support human development. For instance, educational problems of migratory children also concern children of the autochthonous society as well, but it is easier to talk only about the migrant children. Both are discriminated by the educational system. This is an special Austrian problem. In Germany it's also a big discussion. Inclusion offers a way to criticize the system and develop it and help all the social groups with problems. And the migrants help us to realize this. Fifth step, learning to tell positive narratives on flight and migration. For Willem Flusser, the transgression of borders is the most important stimulus for the growing and development of society. He writes, if someone sees the globe from the perspective of the moon, and if he sees it during early Stone Age, he would behold two and just two human buildings, the Roman limes and the Chinese wall. Both are institutions to prevent the settled from the nomadic people. Europe has become the center of the world because the Chinese wall was built better than the limes. The West was fertilized by the nomadic logos grammaticos better than the East. In his collection of articles on the freedom of the migrant, Flusser shows the refugees' and migrants' potentials and resources. In spite of all the discrimination, violence, and even murder within the historical and contemporary processes of flight and migration, migratory experience can teach what human dignity and equality, freedom and justice, recognizing difference and diversity mean individually as well as politically. Migration even can create situations in which utopias of a better world can be born. Such a view has been the exception from the rule in history and in contemporary time. Even migration studies today slowly have started to realize the transformation and creative power of flight and migration for society. Up to now, the disintegration, lack of education, and little willingness to integrate have dominated research. Only in the last few years, the transforming potential of migration for society comes of interest. Research gets aware of the impulse of migration for societal and institutional reform, for individual and collective learning processes, for the culture and the democratic renewal of society, for the contact with diversity and the implementation of the claims for social justice. Sixth step, remembering the biblical narratives. The experiences in the context of flight and migration I have mentioned up to now are the fundamental basis of the Jewish, the Christian, and in some aspects also of the Islamic tradition. For all of them, experiences of flight and migration have become central, if not the central, learning spaces. It's not my own idea to say migration is a learning space. I even find it in the Bible. Jewish, Christian, and Muslim theologies were created in the context of such catastrophes. Of course, the learning outcomes of the three so-called monotheistic religions are quite different, but for us it is interesting to see that the ethical monotheism is deeply connected with flight and migration. Migration experiences obviously have been transformed from traumatic experiences into narratives and practices proposing ways to a good life for all, for each human being, for the society, and for mankind. Further on, I concentrate on the biblical tradition and I show you how I come to all the ideas I mentioned before. The stories in the Bible prevent theology from reducing the meaning of migration to a catastrophe. Ethical monotheism, developed by the writers of the books of the Old Testament, is learned step by step over the course of centuries. It has its roots in the phenomena of migration, displacement, deportation, and diaspora. Migration is what we call in Catholic theology a locus theologicus, a theological space, place, I don't know what is the better word, of biblical theology. It is the most important place where theology is generated. In the Old Testament, migration phenomena are considered bad because they mean suffering, violence, murder, and death. Migration is often seen as a consequence of sin, especially of as a result of injustice and the betrayal of God. For example, Deuteronomy reflects on the exile in Babylon, where the people of Israel had been deported after the destruction of Israel. Living in the diaspora, they start to ask for an explanation of their situation. First, Israel has broken its covenant with the God of their fathers. The people worshipped idols, thus forgetting about the Lord. Secondly, they did not care for justice in their own society according to their law, so that poverty grew throughout Israel. The destruction and deportation of Israel is the consequence of these sins. Israel has to repent, here we have it again, in order to turn back to the Torah. The fruit of these reflections is the development of ethical monotheism characterized by two main principles. You see, ethical monotheism is not a philosophical idea, it's really the inner sense of the experience of diaspora. And these two principles are to avoid a catastrophe like this deportation in the future, the Lord has to be worshipped truly, and the people are obliged to establish a just society. For this purpose, Israel develops laws for the religious cult and for society. Taking responsibility for the poor, the widows, and the orphans, as well as for the strangers, is at the heart of the law. It serves as an indicator as to whether the people of Israel are or are not loyal to the Lord. Practicing faith in God is connected to the responsibility for justice. Accordingly, the theology of migration is the result of a learning process within the context of migration. The suffering is considered bad. It is not legitimized spiritually, but perceived as a commitment to learn in religious as well as in political terms. The concrete socio-political situation becomes a context for questions about the religious meaning of migration. Crucially, the results are practical. The learning process consists of indispensable elements. First, perceiving the initial situation as it is, breaking in of reality, migration in Europe, including all the bad and evil, all the suffering. Secondly, exploring one's own contribution to this situation, which includes recognizing one's own guilt. Thirdly, remembering history and the religious tradition and relearning it in the light of the current tragedy. Fourthly, being willing to repent and being open to transformation. Through this complex process, the people become able to develop new ways of religious and political life. It is what I called a process of metanoia in the beginning. Metanoia is not just an inner thing, it had also political and social transformation consequences. Moreover, the theology of migration is the result of a spiritual and an ethical learning process. This learning process can be detected in most of the biblical stories of the Old Testament. Part of this learning process is, of course, also learning to deal with aggression, with hatred and xenophobia against strangers. You can find passages like this, because you have to learn to deal with it, which you also can find there. It is a century-lasting process to learn to recognize and love the other. The experience of the Exodus is the source of this theology. Even if the biblical account is not accurate in historical critical terms, the story of the escape from slavery in Egypt becomes the core narrative of the people of Israel. The flight from a brutal religious and political regime becomes the center of migration theology. This experience is the point of departure for asking about God and the ethical and political implication of one's faith. The learning outcome is the conviction that only God is the Lord of history, such that human beings are not allowed to rule over each other through violence or exploit each other for personal interests. All the famous so-called Judeo-Christian values, I heard this every day in the Austrian newspapers, all these famous values to which public and political discourses refer repeatedly were created in this process of reflection. The dignity and equality of every human being, Genesis 1, because migrants are not a flood or a wave for a mass of people, but persons with biographies. The experience of the unity of humanity in Genesis 10, because migrants and non-migrants are all members of the human family. The dignity of the stranger and the duty to love her or him, Leviticus 19:34, and many parallels, because the people of Israel had been strangers and slaves themselves, but were liberated by God. Migration history is the root of obligation to care for the poor while recognizing difference. Taking the catastrophe of the destruction and deportation of Israel as a stimulus, the people of Israel transformed the curse of migration into a blessing. In the biblical tradition, this term includes a practical agenda, because spiritual experience and political learning are not separated. In this way, the logic of salvation can be learned. The theology of migration is not an abstract theory, but learned step by step under different and diverse circumstances. It is a process of learning, remembering, and metanoia. Theology of migration has to be remembered and renewed again and again, because the people of God fail consistently, forgetting their principles. In order to avoid this forgetting, memorizing and studying become central institution for the Jewish people, maybe one of the most important gifts for Christians and Muslims. The practices of memorizing help to learn hope in difficult and devastating situations. Hope, therefore, is not just an inner feeling or a kind of optimism, it is a mental project. And it's a practical orientation during hard times that there is a meaning, not to forget that there is a meaning to everything that happens, a meaning which will become clear in the end. Theologically speaking, it means not to lose one's orientation towards God, being convinced that the Lord will help. Such hope is well educated, eminently practical, and can be learned through training. It follows an inner spiritual logic. Since it has been possible to transform catastrophes into new life in the past, such transformation will be possible in the time to come. Since God kept his promise to liberate his people in the past, God will do so in the future in spite of their sins. However, the help of God is connected to the action of human beings. This rationality can also be found in a variety of books of the New Testament, especially in the Gospels. The members of the communities behind the Gospels and epistles were neither migrants nor refugees, but the socio-political circumstances in which they were living were also disastrous. Within these communities, there were many families who had lost members to the persecution of Christians by the Roman Empire. Many Jewish Christians had been crucified by the Roman government. The temple in Jerusalem was destroyed, a disaster for both Jews and Jewish Christians, for whom the loss of their spiritual and ritual center meant a loss of hope. Within the pagan surrounding, they were treated as strangers. Under these circumstances, the Jewish Christians did what Jews always had done to cope with the crisis. They remembered their narratives, utilizing them as a hermeneutical tool to interpret the current situation. In accordance with their migrant ancestors, they took the situation as a moment for living and learning faith. Since these narratives helped to draw hope from the long histories the Jews shared with God, the Jewish Christian dared to trust in the old promises again and anew. God has liberated his people in the past, God will liberate them again in the future. The core of the tradition implied that God is capable of creating new life amidst complete despair. In the story of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Jewish experience becomes concrete again. The new faith is a result of remembering and interpreting their tradition with their scriptures, with the Torah and the prophets. Crucially, the stories that reopen redemption in the current crisis are the stories of migrants. It comes at no surprise that the migratory hermeneutic shaped many stories of early Christians. For instance, Jesus and the disciples led the life of itinerant preachers in the Galilee among the poor. Jesus describes himself as homeless. Matthew uses the motive of the flight to Egypt to show the deep connection of Jesus of Nazareth to Israel. Jesus has to be liberated by God, brought out of Egypt. So Egypt can be seen as a place of redemption because Jesus crosses borders, becoming now the Messiah of all the non-Jewish people. Hence, the pagans are now able to connect with Israel, thus finding their way to the Lord. Again, a migrant, Jesus of Nazareth, turns out to be a locus theologicus for the revelation of God. Moreover, the disciples of Jesus are asked to live without a stable home, as homeless people, in order to proclaim the kingdom of God. In Hebrew 11:13 and in the first letter of Peter, explain that the experience of being a stranger and a guest is a constitutive dimension of belonging to the Christian community. In the letter of the Ephesians, the concept of paroikoi, the Greek word for migrants with the right of residence, is used to interpret the identity of Christian with pagan origin. Because of the redemption of Jesus Christ, they are no longer strangers without any civil rights. They use political metaphors for the belonging to this community, which is very exciting for me. But they are now full citizens among the holy people and housemates of God. The reconciliation between Jews and non-Jews thus is described with the hermeneutics of migration and political metaphors. Last but not least, encountering a stranger means encountering Jesus Christ himself in Matthew 24. Accordingly, biblical stories can be seen as stories of how to live and how to learn faith. Many of these learning processes took place in the context of the experience of migration. It is within the context of crisis, then, that theology is born. Nonetheless, the experience of migration is not necessary to learn about God. Refugees and migrants are not nearer to God than other human beings. As we also see in the Bible, there are good and bad people, victims and victimizers among them. However, the experience of migration obviously allows for the intensification of some of the experiences that enable us to experience God. Powerlessness, dependence, fragility, vulnerability. The experience of being excluded can facilitate the possibility as well as the ability to ask for God and to thus become aware of God's presence. Of course, settled people like me also can experience God in such a way, but for them it might be harder as they can rely on their own security. Also, experiences of being a stranger seem to be seminal sources for sustained spiritual practice and theological reflection. Learning processes do not happen automatically, neither for migrants nor for non-migrants, but there are conditions we can learn from the biblical stories. One has to be ready to criticize oneself, willing to remember and willing to repent, and being open to transformation. One has to prepare to ask what current occurrences mean for oneself and for oneself with others. What does God demand from me, from us now? What is my what is our responsibility for this situation? And what kind of, which kind of transformation am I or are we asked for? This little provocative, it's easier to help victims than to ask these questions oneself. Yes, what is my responsibility for all of this? Crucially, these questions are the central questions for Europe today facing flight and migration. The curse of migration today could be turned into a blessing if Europeans were willing to enter a process of remembering, learning and metanoia. It is obvious that this is not an easy task and requires a lot of courage. It is hard because Europe's economic and political system is not on the side of migrants, but rather comparable to Egypt or Babylon. For Europeans, then, the challenges are different, but the dynamics at the heart of these challenges might be the same. Catholic perspectives. I'm coming to an end. Little patience. It's not so much. Catholic is not so wrong. But I want you to see that Catholic perspectives are not just crazy ideas, but founded in the Bible. And I thought when I come here and talk to Protestant people, I have to refer to the Bible a lot. You know, in the Catholic tradition, this is not so, it's not normal. Catholic perspectives. Building on this biblical tradition, the Catholic Church has developed the theology of migration. There is a papal instruction called Erga Migrantes Caritas Christi, the love of Christ towards migration. And this paper is one of the seminal sources for the current situation, 2004. I mean, the Catholic Church has been dealing with migration issues since the 1950s. It's one of the oldest and worldwide institutions who made theology and made practical issues. In the Catholic Church, migration and this paper, it is considered a sign of the times. I quote it, "We can therefore consider the present-day phenomenon of migration a significant sign of the times, a challenge to be discovered and utilized in our work to renew humanity and proclaim the gospel of peace." In Catholic teaching, a sign of the times is a historical event that transforms the mindset of the majority of the members of a society. Seen through the eyes of faith, this event can be perceived as a situation in which God Himself reveals, thus transforming it into an experience of grace. Of course, migration as such is not a place of grace. This interpretation would be rather cynical. However, migration can turn or be turned into an experience of grace if it is interpreted as a challenge to proclaim the gospel of peace, which sets a practical agenda. Erga Migrantes shows the same logic as the biblical tradition translated into contemporary times. A sign of the times simultaneously encourages and demands human activity. That means grace and doing something for the grace. This is hard for Protestants, but that's really Catholic, are deeply connected to each other. Yeah? The document goes even further. The passage from monocultural to multicultural societies can be a sign of the living presence of God in history and in the community of mankind, for it offers a providential opportunity for the fulfillment of God's plan for a universal communion. Through this process of transformation, then, God, God's self, can be experienced. This experience is inextricably interwoven with practical duties. And so we can read there, therefore, to become grace, therefore Christians are called to give witness to and practice not only the spirit of tolerance, which is a great thing, but also respect for the other's identity, and we are all therefore called to a culture of solidarity so as to achieve together a real communion of persons. This is the laborious path that the Church invites everyone to follow. The Catholic Church knows that it recommends a difficult and demanding process of learning, a process which has political ramifications. Hence, Erga Migrantes reflects on the migration not only from a hermeneutical perspective, but also from ethical and political angles. It says, International migration must therefore be considered an important structural component of the social, economic, and political reality of the world today. The large numbers involved call for closer and closer collaboration between countries of origin and destination, in addition to adequate norms capable of harmonizing the various legislative provisions. The aims of this would be to safeguard the needs and rights of the emigrants and their families, and likewise those of the societies receiving them. There is an obligation to take care for both sides. At the same time, however, migration raises a truly ethical question: the search for a new international economic order for a more equitable distribution of the goods of the earth. It means what you can hear from the Pope Francis these days all the time is not a new invention of discourse. It has a long tradition in the Catholic Church, but in the German-speaking countries, nobody knows this. I know that's not right. The German bishops, they are really great. The Austrians do not know this so much. Okay. Well, this is filled. Okay. Accordingly, the theology of migration elaborated in Ego Migrantes paints a picture of the future through remembering the biblical narratives in a way that allows for the replication for the current situation according to biblical logic. It says, foreigners are also, and this is a vision, a visible sign and an effective reminder of that universality which is a constituent element of the Catholic Church. A vision of Isaiah announced this: in the days to come, the mountain of the people of Yahweh — I know that Jews don't like to hear this Yahweh, but yes, it's even like this — shall tower above the mountains. All the nations will stream to it. Isaiah 2:2. In the Gospel, our Lord himself prophesied that people from east and west, from north and south, would come to take their places at the feast in the kingdom of God. Luke 13:29. And the Apocalypse sees a huge number from every nation, race, tribe, and language. Acts 7:9. The Church is now toiling on its way to this final goal. Today's migrations can remind us of this huge number and can be seen as a call and a prefiguration of the final meeting of all humanity with God and in God. This perspective, and it's a narrative, can give hope, enabling and equipping people to experience the current challenges not just as a problem, but as a point of departure for the creation of a better world. At the same time, the Church points out that international migration is rooted in sin, emphasizing the deep split in humanity. However, by taking migration as an opportunity to become active in the history of salvation, sin can be healed. This is the deep hope of the Church according to the biblical memory. It is an ambitious spiritual conclusion with a potentially enormous political impact. Last point. Of course, neither the biblical stories nor the biblical law can be applied directly to today's global and local challenges. The contexts are completely different. In biblical times, there were no international movements, no nation states, and no political orders as we know today. There were fewer people, no global economy, and no military weapons with global reach. Moreover, reasons for migration were as different as social and cultural frameworks. Also, the teaching of the Catholic Church cannot be applied directly unto each and every situation in the same way. Neither the Bible nor the papal instruction offer a political program. However, they can suggest a way of describing, perceiving, and dealing with the challenge of flight and migration. Through the cooperation between migrants and non-migrants, populations and governments, societal institutions and experts, they have to be translated into current context to become and to be helpful. Theological perspectives of flight and migrations remind us of important spiritual, ethical, and political principles that have been learned in the course of history. Reflecting on migration theologically, we can show that solutions to contemporary problems are to be found by remembering history, learning within new contexts, asking for the different responses and responsibilities, thus being willing to transform one's way of living, being willing to metanoia. Theology can contribute to a resource-oriented approach to migration by reminding us of the origin of the values of human dignity, the unity of mankind, and the juridical and political recognition of the stranger asking for help. Perceiving migration as a possibility to learn justice, peace, and living together in diversity, perhaps also as a possibility to learn about God, can give people hope in extreme difficult situations. Theology does not trivialize the tragedies of flight and migration, but it can show how catastrophes can be transformed into chances for human flourishing. Thank you for your patience.